So, welcome again. We need to restart in a second. So, as I was saying, I will talk about bits, plain imaging data structure, and why I think it's an easy way to share your data and has a good example of how, by using simple ideas, we can make the community to do a shift and start sharing their data. So, I will start by the credit of that. So, that was published in Scientific Data. So that describes basically how it's organized, describes the structure of the data sharing. And so it's supported by INCF, which is the International No Imaging Consortium Facility. So it's an informatic-based kind of people which helps to develop things across the world for brain imaging and neuroscience in general. And then the main contributor really is Chris Kopolewski, who was the first author of that paper, but he's the driving force in BITS. And that's the guy there in the middle, who is now in Stanford. And so, what I thought about the talk is to try to understand how the BITS started and why it got adopted quite quickly. Why nothing shows up? It's a different question. So what's special about brain imaging? What is BITS? And what's the recipe that basically BITS followed? And how you could use that kind of same recipes, which I think works quite well. And that's why I think we could, you know, take that as a good example of how we can make it happen. And just to finish up is like the idea of you develop a standard for your field, and then once you have that standard, what can you do once you have that standard in place? Just a word on why do we want to do data sharing. So basically, the five first items on that list have nothing to do with biomedical science. Right? I do biomedical science, that's only the last point. First point, required by funders, so we live in the UK, and basically, RCUK said now you have to share your data, unless you have good reason not to. The other aspect is that it reduces cost of research, returns on investment. Right? You acquire data, you got funded to acquire this data, we can have secondary use. Therefore, it means now the cost of research is lower. That will improve publications and data quality. Right? That's the issue of reproducibility of your own research. And it will accelerate basically the progress, the fundamental understanding of the given topic. Since now you're sharing data, people can use it, we can accumulate data from different groups, and therefore we can have cumulative science and better and start to answer questions that we couldn't before. But the last point is specific to neuroimaging and to biomedical science in general, which is this allows to foster advances in clinical practice. Right? I share biomedical data because maybe you can find something in these data that I couldn't figure out. And which means we can maybe have faster pathways to treatment or help and help people. That's the kind of more specific to biomedical. So what's so special about the brain imaging? So brain imaging itself got plenty of techniques. And then here BITS is at the moment specific to MRI, now it's getting extended to other aspects. So you've probably all seen an MRI before, right, of the brain of somebody. It looks like this one there, if you're healthy. Second one, you're not so healthy, you unfortunately have a brain tumor. And then this is the kind of more advanced things we use in research, which will come up at some point into the clinical practice, which are structural imaging, such as diffusion, so we can look at the neurons, at the tracks of the different neurons. We can look also at the activity, this is functional MRI, how it's activated in the brain, which part of the brain is active in different regions. And despite the fact that we all do experiments on understanding the brain and how it works and how it works in disease, everybody organizes the data a different way. Everybody just used to store the data in a different way and to inform the data in different ways. We also tend to analyze the data in many different ways. There is no harmonization, even though we all have the same kind of question behind the scene. And so that's how basically you get lost in your data, because you've got a heterogeneity of data, are not good way to describe it, right? So you've got problem in data sharing, lot of metadata inputs, and it means if you download somebody else's data set, you're gonna take loads and loads of time to try to understand that data set. And that's how people, so you've got little incentive to share it, and even if you share, then it becomes very complicated because the user is gonna ask you so many questions that you say, well, next time I'm not gonna share it because it's just too much work. Right, the posts, people who comes back to you because they can't understand how you shared your data. And so you have to think, another step which is quite useful is to think about the complexity of the data that you want to share. And so, for instance, Beads is designed to share raw data. So raw data in neural imaging is about from something about 10 gigabytes to several terabytes. Right, that depends on the type of data we're talking about. But then from these raw data, for instance, you can create derived data, so some sort of summary of this, which are quite easy to share, it's a few hundred megabytes. And you can already extract the last bits, which is like in a paper, which is just, you know, tables and CSV file. So any kind of data that you want to share, you have to think about what's the level at which you want to share it. And so the way that pyramid works is that the most useful would be actually the raw data plus any kind of stuff you derive from it. So then it's very big, but then anybody can access from the very beginning of the data processing to the last bits that you've done. So you share the absolutely everything. Beads tends to focus more on the raw data, although you can, you know, extend towards derived data as well. But it's something that you have to consider when you want to share the data. What aspect of it is useful. And so, simple way to organize neural imaging data, but so that's the plan of Beads. It's designed for the PI, also for workflow developers, so that's something I will talk about after. But once you have a standard, then you can develop automated way to look and analyze the data. And of course, our dataset curators. So the way it looks, is that that's why it's called a structure, because it's not about the format. It's really just about how you're going to put the data out there so that somebody can go in it and understand right away the way you've done it. So typical experiments in imaging is kind of hierarchical. So you have each subject, inside each subject you have different type of data, and so each time they use, obviously, names that. So you collect the data like this, and then you organize it into a hierarchy. And inside each subject, you've got your data, subject 1, 2, 3. Inside each subject, you've got different names that we come up with. And then inside each of these folders, you've got the data themselves. Now, for each data, as you can see, it comes with also different type of files. So we'll talk a little bit about these. But the idea is really that anyone can now find out his way around the data. So all basically Chris had to come up with is to say, okay, this is the way we're going to store the data on Drive and how we're going to share it. And it's pretty much what people were doing anyway, because it kind of makes sense to share, to organize the data that way for us. So for you, it's like, okay, what's the natural way to organize the data? And let's agree that that's the way everybody's going to do it. So that when you open somebody else's data, you already know where to look. You don't spend the first hour figuring out, how does the guy organize his data? Where are the data for each subject, for the group, for the derived data, for the code? You already know because it's an agreed structure. The second aspect, which I think makes it to work easy, is that for each data, so you've got participant CSV and JSON. So we use two types of additional files, JSON files, which are text files, and actual TXT or TSV file for tabulated separated values rather than comma separated values. And then that's it. There's nothing else. So which means the metadata are the metadata that can be read by any software. No proprietary format, obviously, so you just use plain text. In our case, TSV, JSON. Everybody can read it. Every machine can read it. And it's easy to understand what it is. And the last aspect in the data themselves is that we use something called Nifty, which is just the way we store the data. So that would be, say, if you use pictures, you want to use, you know, JPEG, PNG, we don't want to come up with a new format. Before this, some people attempted to share the data, but they come up with their own format, which means let's share the data. This is a new framework, but you have to use a format that nobody has ever used, which works only in one software. Nifty, every single brain imaging software in the world can read Nifty files. And everybody pretty much using Nifty. So it's like, okay, why does it work? Why does it get adopted? Because the recipe is use a format that people already use, use plain text, and just organize the data in logical ways. Right? So we didn't, you know, when they created Beats, they didn't come up with like, hey, here's a super complicated new and fancy way to do it. It was more, or rather, a kind of, here's the way most people do it. Let's just agree on the terms and the words that we use to describe it. So if you want to use an anatomical scan, we call it anatomical. And there's a sequence in MRI called T1, we call it T1. Let's not call it with another name. So basically, it comes with a little dictionary. So you go on the website. So you go on the website, which will describe different things about it. And then you can go on the specification. And basically, you have a dictionary. So if you don't know how to call a given file, I will tell you, okay, this type of sequences you get from your data, this is how you call it. Now, another aspect which makes it work as well is because there is a validator. So as a person who does data curation, for instance, you would tell somebody, this is the way you want to store your data. But then they created a little tool so that if I do it on my own computer, when I curate the data, I can use the validator, which will simply read the tree, make sure I've got the files which follow the agreed dictionary, and that follows the agreed, like there's a TSV file, that there's a JSON file. So it looks for these files. It's not going to read the content of this file, or it's going to look at the structure of it. And so the validator is kind of, and it's actually through Chrome. I mean, you can run it on your own computer if you want, but you can also just use it through a browser. So for a lot of people, it's much easier for them simply to go on the browser, click on the button, and then the browser is going to check that the data, the folders that you say contain all the information that you want. So that makes another thing which is useful, because then, as a curator, you're not going to curate data for everybody. It's too much work, and the universities don't pay for that. So your job, if you want to convince people to adopt the standard, is to convince them to do it. But then once they do it, they are not necessarily sure that it's done properly. So if you have a little tool which simply says, yep, we're happy, it looks fine, then it makes people more confident that they can do it. Right? So the little extra tool is also something which has been helped quite a lot. And so this way to do the data sharing was actually only started in 2015, and then presented at our big annual meetings that we have, and introduced in the informatics community, and then published not too long after that. And so if you think about it, 2015, you know, we have 2017 in 2 years, and lots of people now are using it. Because I think the recipe is that simple. So that's basically, I think, the main recipe is how do you make it to happen? Well, the main obstacle is humans, right? And so I don't know if you heard about the 28 rules before. And you know, it comes from basically PCA kind of analysis where 80% of the data are explained by only 20% of the components. And so that's the same for any kind of stuff. So the idea is to say, well, with 20% of work, you're going to produce 80% of your output. So that means you want to propose something for people to use a structure which is not going to make a lot of work. Most people already organize, for instance, the data the way Beats propose it to be organized. And so that means that it's not extra work for the users to decide they're going to share data, because it's already in a structure which is similar to what they do. There's a little bit of changes, but it's not a lot of extra work. So if you want people to start to share their data, that's a good way to make it happen, because you tell them, hey, you know, this is only the little changes you have to do. We used an agreed standard. Again, we use Nifty. So if in your field you use JPEG, don't come up with, you know, a completely new format for images. Just use what's out there. The validation, I think, worked quite well. The other aspect, it assumes very little computational skills. Although most imagers are quite computer savvy, I would say, not everybody is. And so always assume that the people who want to share their data are not necessarily people which are very good with computers. Make it simple. The two other aspects are computers, which can make it difficult to share data, because it's about how your data will make it through the web. If tomorrow I search for data, how do I know that, you know, Google can find it or any other engine? And so it means you use text files, plain text files, JSONs, XML. For us, it's text and TSV, but, you know, you use CSV, you use stuff that's already out there and which is machine readable. But the last part is institutions, which also sometimes are not helping to share the data, but nowadays we've got data publications, so you can do papers for data. Most repositories come with DOI, so the data that you put out there are protected. And so that's the other aspect, which is not in bits, but basically bits encapsulates the data in a way that is easy to put on the repository to get a DOI. And then the last aspect about data sharing and how to make data sharing happen. So we've got bits, it's great. It works nicely, but I would say the format and how easy it was to make the format for people to use, it's probably 50% of the success of it. Even if you come up with a brilliant idea on how to make things happen, it's 50%. The other 50% is community outreach. It's the same as software sustainability. You can make your software open source, open development, but if you don't have a community around it, basically things are not going to happen. And so Chris published the paper last year in Scientific Data, and since then, they outreach about 5,000 researchers, loads of emails, prepared different data sets. The first paper was 27 co-authors. And why I mention this is because it's really about inclusivity in credit work. That's why there's 27 authors. Because if you go on the website, you can see the specifications, but what you can see as well, so we've got the data sets, you need your feedback. Now, this is all the different extensions for which we're already working on for bits. And so if you look, that's the initial draft that was published there. And you can go on it, and everything is open. And you can see the contributions of everybody, because on Google Doc, everything is version controlled. And you can see everybody who's we resolve the issue as they come up. But that means to get the community outreach is that, of course, you need activities like people talking to others. But you have a Google Doc, you've got open discussions, contributions, open drafts. Everything is open. So anybody who will contribute then will be included in whatever activities will come out of the next aspect of BITS. So that's how you get people involved in your project, because they don't fear to get involved, say, yeah, but, you know, I don't know much about this. It doesn't matter. You don't know much about some aspect of the JSON files and informatics, but you acquire data that nobody else has. Therefore, it doesn't exist in our dictionary. Right? So we need to come up with new ideas of implementing the dictionary because you've got data that we don't have before. So you become a contributor. Having said all of that, the fact that we've got open group, open discussions, community and stuff. As I wrote there, we still need some data reinforcement. Clearly, Chris, you know, is behind it. And so community outreach is great. You got more people involved, but you still have, you know, just somebody behind the whole thing. Now, the last step I wanted to touch is what you can do once you have your standard. So once you develop a standard such as Bit, and you get into the data sharing, you get people to share using an agreed standard. Well, in our case, we've got another repository which is OpenNeuro, but it means that it becomes easy for, say, if you are a data curator who at the library in your university, then it becomes very easy because all the data follow already a given format. So you can make sure that the data which comes in are already validated, and so you know that all the meta information is in there. Then we developed Bits app. So now people who do programming, then they can develop workflows because we know that we have CSV file, and we know the structure. So now I can write an app which will download the data and do all the basic analysis of the data images right away. Because it's easy since I know the structure and I know that all the meta information is in there and I know the format and I know the dictionary. So I can program it. So which means all the basic pre-processing for brain imaging can be done completely automatically. And what kind of pre-processing? Well, for instance, you can do all your quality control. So now if you want to download data sets, they are all in agreed formats. You can download data sets from 3, 4, 10 universities. You can combine them. But if you combine them, you want to make sure they all have the same quality. So we can develop completely automatic workflow. This is completely automatic. You download something which is in the Bits format, you run the MRI QC, it just outputs all the files with all the metrics. So now you can combine data because you've got extra metrics simply because you have a structure and a format that everybody agreed upon. And you can find problems in your images, like spikes. So we see these images are some weird artifacts. And so what's the future of this? Well, we're gonna load of things is gonna be hypothesis generation machine. Because now because we have got the grid structure, you can accumulate all of this data together. As I was saying at the beginning, brain imaging loads of different ways to look at the same data. So in informatics it's typically called analytical complexity. Is the fact that the same data set can be looked at in many different ways. Now it becomes very simple since you have the same agreed structure, you can run multiple ways and multiple apps on the same structure and see what the outputs are. Okay, some people develop different apps, we can compare the results with the same underlying data. Is it stable? Do you get the same results? And then of course, one of the things that this is keen to is to extend it to the machine learning community. So that's a separate project where basically all the imaging data are transferred to a different type of format. And then you've got the BID extension, PET, MEG. So now that we know it works for MRI, is how we can use the same recipe. And so that's basically what it's on the website. So we've got PET extensions, derivative extensions, model extension. And so it's already like how we can use the same recipe since it works so well for MRI so that we can use other modalities of brain imaging. So same idea. Don't change the format. Use the format people are already using. Create a dictionary and use TSV and, you know, JSON files as I said. So it's really making it easy for people to convert the data they already have. That's really the recipe and outreach. And that's it. That's me. So I don't know if you have any specific questions on if you want to see, let's see how it looks like. So it's the same, you know, part of a format. So if you create a format, then you want to show examples as well of that format. So everything is on GitHub because it's just easier. So you take a given data set. And so as I was saying, you've got all the subjects, then you've got the README, the data description, the participants, so you get different subjects, so you want to say, you want to know about subjects, and so sex, age, basic demographics, data description. So it's a JSON file. If you never see JSON, see there's nothing special about it. That's just a text file with curly brackets at the top and the bottom. And so the parameters are, that's, you know, just like the standard stuff about what's the license, what's the experiment, what's the founders. So all of this is described into the library. Then you get into a given subject. The name of the folders, again, are names which have been agreed upon. So anatomical for anatomical data, func for functional data. And then you should have, so that's the nifty file. And that's a TSV file which comes with it. And again, tabulated format, so for people in the field, all the names which are in there are, you know, they mean something. But again, because it's a TSV file, the machine can read it easily, right? You don't get into proprietary format, which only a given software can read. And so, for instance, I used to, or I still do a lot of my work using MATLAB, but more and more we're using Python, right? Because it's completely free, so may as well. But it doesn't really matter when you use a TSV file, whatever software you want, you can use R, you can use Python, you can use MATLAB, you can use whatever you want. Every software can read it. Now, if I was using MATLAB and I would store everything as a MAT file, then it becomes a problem because, right, I need to find something which converts MATLAB to R, to Python, to whatever. So it's another layer of complexity that you don't really want to have when you describe the data.
Can I ask a bit about the work you're doing on extensions? Never having designed, you know, as you're adding these extensions on, is there, have any of those extensions challenged the basic, you know, 1.0.0 structure? Where you wish that you had done something different, or you know, I guess, or maybe you as coming in, you know, a request that people are making for extensions, challenging the basic format.
Not that I've seen so far, because it's really about using what. I think there's two aspects. It's using what already people are using. And then, so for instance, let's say we always have new stuff coming up because MRI, we always have new sequences. Well, if we say PET, our PET was like MRI, but there's new other stuff that you want to talk about, such as what kind of chemicals you've been using and so on. And so again, the way it works is basically we go into Google Groups, somebody ask a question, say, hey, I've got this data set, there's no description on how do I share that data set. So sometimes they already propose themselves some tags to put in the JSON file. Sometimes they don't know, and so you just somebody answer say, okay, well, I'm actually collecting this kind of data too. So I was thinking this is what are the tags we can use. And then, you know, because you've got a community of people on the list, you agree on something. Once we reach a decision, we put it on the draft. People can still comment on the draft anyway. And that's pretty much it. That's the way it happens. It's very community driven and not anybody who comes up with, you know, this is the way it's going
to
happen.
But at some point, someone has to say, well, that's the way it is because you have to incorporate it into the validator, right? I mean, at some point, someone has to draw the line.
That's what I mean. That's where it goes in the draft. So we have a discussion on the Google group. But it resolves. I mean, so far, I see it's resolving pretty quickly. Like, you know, you start up something, maybe 2 or 3 weeks later, it's resolved. I mean, it appears on the draft. So for any kind of, I think it's a good model as community engagement and outreach so that people get involved. Because it's really, you know, if it's only driven by somebody, you go against adoption, right? Because you say, well, I don't really like the way they've done it. Whereas there, if you're not happy about something, you just say, I don't think, like, there's revisions compared to the paper, there's slight changes. Because some people come up and say, well, you know, that way is not very flexible because we can't do this and that, which people didn't think about at the time. And so we're just revising it. No worries. There's nothing set in stone. As long as it's out there and you've got a clear description and version, right? The different versions at which you release. So you can say, well, I release my version as bid 1.0, 1.1, bids 1.2. So you also have a version of the bids at which your data were released. And like on OpenNeuro, we keep updating it so that it's always the latest. So you also have a version control on how, in the format at which you're actually going to share your data. Right. At some point. How we would engage with a new community.
So like your story of what you've done here, people were to apply this to cell biology or something else, something completely different, different problems, like is there a basic framework, like the questions you ask of yourselves, what do we all use, which file format do we all use, how should we structure it, what's the common, like is there a way to approach that you can share with people?
And so the way this happened is through, it happened through INCF. So that's the main, through INCF. That's the main, that's the way it happened, through that organization.
What's
INCF? So that's the International Neuroinformatic Consortium. And so basically, it's funded by many different governments. And it's and so they have like a special force on data sharing. So we put a group of people who want to work on data sharing. And then out of this came this. So to answer your question, you need to have an organization which is supranational, right? So I don't know, society could do the job as well. You can have, in our case, OHPM. Well, actually, now it works a little bit with OHPM, but like our society doesn't really. It's an organization rather than a society. So, for instance, they don't really fund activities. Say through SFN, right? So Society for Neuroscience, they fund activities. So you could have special workshops created through SFN for neuroscience, where you say, okay, what? And then you have this discussion, which is the Kickstarter of your, of your format. So in humanities, imagine that it's the same, that you have societies and stuff like that. And then you can say, well, what's the format that we use for these kind of files? And then you kind of start it. I mean, after that, it's really a matter of community on how people agree on how you do it.
I think it's worth contrasting as well, sort of how you folks organize this compared to many of the other minimum information standards, which have kind of failed. So the BID standard itself is really a very simple format, right? You're not really necessarily saying what a person needs. There were a lot of these papers published in Nature and Nature Methods, where they got hundreds of authors on the paper, and to say, oh, okay, so you can't publish an experiment unless you have this bit of data and this bit of information, and then no one ever uses it. And I think you guys actually had people using the format as you were developing it.
Yeah, because I think it's really a matter of minimal constraints. So for instance, we do bids for EEG, and there is another group who has developed something for EEG. But it's the same. They developed it as bioinformatics people, and they developed it in a way which is basically, we can encapsulate everything about your experiment into one big file. But then again, you need to learn about using that file, using their format, using... So that's extra work for the researcher. This is not extra work for the researcher. This is extra work, but this is a tiny bit of extra work. This is, 20%. You've done 80% already. You only have to do 20% extra to be able to share your data as bits.
And it just looks like, from the outside, that once you've got it in your head, how it works, and that's just how you store your stuff as you go.
Exactly. Like every new data, don't
like
think about it.
It's like showing people like to organize their shit, and it's a side effect that you can share it afterwards.
That's it, because then that becomes just the way you do it as your normal work, because there's nothing more. Just at the end, you will create these JSON files that you would not have normally. That's practically the only extra stuff that you have. Because now, when I store my data come in, I store them that way, and the rest is in TSV file as well. And when I'm ready to share, I create the JSON files, and that's it. So as you said, it's because it's not extra work. That's really, I think, the key. And that's what you're saying, is that, you know, we come up with these fantastic new ways to do things, but then it's a lot of extra work. And you don't, as a researcher, you don't want to do that. You just want to get on with your work, get it done, get it published, make your founder happy, and not say, oh, actually, I'm going to spend another year just to be able to share it.